Israel, with an estimated 6,000 startups, has the largest number of startups per capita in the world by far. It ranks third on the list of countries with the most companies on the NASDAQ, only surpassed by the US and China. And these aren't some two-bit companies either. Israeli startups like Wix and Fiverr are killing it out there. Waze sold to Google for $1.3 billion, and more recently, Mobileye to Intel for $15.3 billion, among many others. So how did Israel, a tiny country with a population of only around 8.5 million people, become known as the startup nation, all while fending off near constant war and without any natural resources to speak of? Israeli high tech is booming. The country produces more startup companies than India, Japan, Korea, Canada, and the UK. It's a research and development powerhouse, with Apple, Amazon, Facebook, Google, and Intel among the many companies relying on Israel's more than 300 R&D centers to keep them on the cutting edge. In fact, Israel was just named fifth on Bloomberg's annual list of most innovative countries and number one for research and development. Now, throw into the mix the barrage of international boycotts and violent conflicts, and you're left scratching your head. How did this wave of Israeli innovation come to be? Was it always like this? Not even close. Ever since its founding in 1948, all the way up to the early 90s, Israel was not in the best economic shape. With very few resources, the newly established state was a semi-socialist backwater and was basically out of money from the get-go. And resources were spread even thinner when nearly 700,000 Holocaust survivors and Jews from Muslim countries immigrated, basically doubling the country's population. Israel managed to scrape by financially by accepting controversial reparation payments from Germany in 1953. Still, the decades that followed didn't bring much in the way of economic improvement. The 1970s and 80s saw Israel fall victim to a terrible recession and hyperinflation, which rose as high as 445% by 1984. So, how did Israel pull a complete 180, earning the nickname of Startup Nation in little more than a decade? Well, first, we have to back up a century. Now, Jewish tradition had always valued education, so naturally, the early Israelis invested in knowledge and brain power, establishing the Technion Institute of Technology in 1912, Hebrew University in 1925, and the Weizmann Institute of Science in 1934. Okay, but Israel isn't exactly the only country with universities, so what was different about Israel? Well, the answer might just lie within the unique challenges the country has faced. Israeli culture, from its earliest inception, needed to think outside the box in order to survive. Israel won its 1948 War of Independence in spite of a tremendous lack of resources and power, thanks to more than a bit of scrappiness. In that war, Arab forces placed a siege on the main Tel Aviv-Jerusalem highway, barring the entry to Jerusalem from all shipments of food and supplies. To bypass the blockade, the Israelis came up with an ad hoc alternative, the secret construction of a makeshift path along the Judean Mountains that they dubbed the Burma Road. This early example just shows the entire MO of Israeli innovation. Time and time again, when faced with one obstacle or another, Israel would have to blaze an alternate path, a proverbial Burma Road. So what were these obstacles? Well, there was the country's tiny size and economy. Oh, and the small problem of being totally surrounded by enemy states. But one of Israel's greatest challenges was survival without resources like water and oil. Israel had to become an expert in innovative water and energy conservation just in order to survive. Simcha Blass was the best-known water engineer in pre-state Palestine. Early in his career, a farmer drew Blass's attention to a big tree growing in his backyard, seemingly without any water, while all the surrounding trees were stunted. Blass dug below the dry surface and discovered why. Dripping water from a leaky pipe was reaching the roots of this one tree. Blass became engrossed in the concept of drip irrigation, and by the early 1960s, he created an extremely efficient irrigation device that used friction and water pressure to leak drops of water at regular intervals. Half a century later, this innovation is revered by scientists and environmentalists alike, but back in the 60s, it was simply the only way water-starved Israel could afford to irrigate crops. Blass was motivated to help other countries struggling with water resources, ultimately helping to feed the populations of over 110 countries worldwide. But back to high tech. What launched Israel's game-changing high tech boom of the 1990s? Would you believe it if I told you a failed military program likely had something to do with it? After years of relying heavily on arms imported from other countries, only to be slapped by embargo after embargo, Israel decided to invest in the manufacture of its own arms. Israel Aerospace Industries developed the Lavi fighter jet, a wildly advanced Israeli innovation, but also crushingly expensive. The huge project was abandoned in 1987, leaving 5,000 of the most brilliant scientists and engineers looking for work. Suddenly, a combination of creative energy and cutting-edge knowledge was let loose in the emerging high-tech market. It was just at this moment in time, the turn of the decade, when the Iron Curtain fell at last and Soviet Jews were free to leave the former Soviet Union. This included a huge influx of scientists and engineers, not to mention over 700,000 new consumers entering the country at the perfect moment, just when the high-tech sector began to take off. Another big push towards high tech was the Yozma Program, initiated by the Israeli government in 1993, which aimed to attract foreign investments in new startups that were in the incubator stage. This was one of the ways Israel took advantage of the all-new engineering talent from the Soviet Union. It formed an incubator that nurtured startups and created huge incentives for entrepreneurs to take a chance and launch new companies. And in just a few years, Israel had become one of the world's largest and most advanced tech hubs. Many believe that there is another element to Israel's culture of innovation. Yossi Matias, founder of Google's R&D center in Israel, categorizes it as Israeli chutzpah. No matter what you call it, Israelis have been known to be assertive and audacious, with little respect or tolerance for the status quo. They refuse to accept situations as they are if they need improvement. This type of chutzpah seems to view every obstacle as simply another thing to work around. Not an impassable problem, but rather a solution waiting to emerge. This has been true of Israeli solutions to mundane issues like traffic navigation or simplifying web design, thank you Waze and Wix, but it has also been true when addressing larger humanitarian problems. In 1997, Dr. Amit Goffer, already a successful inventor, was in an ATV accident that left him quadriplegic. Having experienced the results of a spinal cord injury, he wanted to help others in similar situations, so he invented ReWalk, something out of a Ridley Scott movie. The ReWalk is a powered wearable exoskeleton which enables people with lower limb paralysis to walk again. When he introduced his invention, doctors were convinced it was a sham until they saw their paralyzed patients walk again. Since that old Burma Road, challenging the norm has become the norm for Israeli society, no matter how discouraging that norm may be. But there's another, maybe less obvious factor that plays a major role in Israel's success with innovation, army service. Israel requires 18-year-old men and women to serve in the military and defend the country for up to 3 years. So what is it about compulsory military service that could help boost Israeli technologies? If anything, doesn't it just set potential entrepreneurs back 3 years while they wait to get on with their lives in the private sector? Not really. Imagine a workforce that gains advanced know-how at an early age using the highest technology available and in scenarios where the stakes aren't financial success, but rather life and death. They regularly practice decision-making in an environment where failure is just not an option. Young soldiers learn to be self-reliant and resourceful. Superiors often tell their subordinates to go figure it out, giving the soldiers the freedom to think differently and to own the situation. These young adults become natural leaders with maturity and perspective gained at a much earlier age than in other countries. Nowhere are these traits more evident than the crack cyber intelligence team known as Unit 8200, attaining almost mythical status. The highly secretive 8200 recruits the best of the best. Hackers, programmers, would-be engineers. It's like the Avengers of tech wizards. And these wizards go on to accomplish some pretty amazing things. 8200 recruit Avishai Avrahami was hacking into the systems of enemy countries in the 90s before he founded Wix. Gil Schwede was decrypting code before he invented the first ever commercial firewall and VPN in 1993. And there are hundreds of other stories just like these. Unit 8200 alumni have founded more than 1,000 startups and have an alumni network that fuels and nurtures new startups all over. So many factors have played a part in Israel's development as a startup nation. From early innovation vital to survival, to immigration, to Israeli and Jewish culture, to IDF service. And Israeli startups are still mixing it up and breaking new ground. Until now, the Israeli model has been create an amazing startup and then sell it off to one of the giants for millions or even billions. But now, many startups are instead choosing to continue their growth on their own, with the aim of becoming giants themselves. Israel seems to be on the verge of graduating from startup nation to an industrial global powerhouse. But this creates a new challenge. How will Israel manage to scale up without losing the scrappy, innovative nature that led to its success to begin with? Thanks for watching. See you guys next week.